Hi, everyone. How are you doing today? Good morning. Welcome to Midland Alliance Church. My name is Rebecca. I just want to welcome each and every one of you who's here, and welcome to those who are joining us from home as well. It is a privilege to be in the house of the Lord this morning, isn't it not? Yeah, it's nice to see more faces at the first service. There must be something in the water getting you up earlier. Anyway, nice to see you here. If you happen to be a guest or newer to the church, I just want to let you know how happy we are that you are with us. We love guests here at MAC. We like people taking that step of checking out a service, you know, tuning into an online service. So if that's you, we would love to give you a gift just to thank you for coming. If you pop by the welcome desk afterwards, we can give you one there, or if you're joining us from home or you'd rather do this on your own, you can go to our website, machurch.ca. There's also a QR code on the card in front of you if you just want to snap that. And then by filling out a contact card, not only will you get a gift, but we will pledge a donation to a local charity on your behalf. That's something that we do every week because we love guests and we love our community. You love guests too? Woo! Yeah, so I just wanted to share a couple pictures. We had the Day of Joy here yesterday. I just want to give a big shout out to Wanda, the head of our women's ministry. We've just got a couple pictures we want to share with you. We had over 60 women here, and it was really a delight, a nice time together, and great message, great music, women connecting with one another. So big thank you to Wanda for putting that together. We are in week two of our church-wide study, and this is the week where our midweek groups are starting. So if you haven't signed up for a group yet and you've been thinking about it, you haven't missed anything yet, okay? There is still time to join. You can do that in the lobby after the service. You'll see there's some sign-up sheets there for the groups that still have spots, so we would just love for you to join one. There's groups here in Midland, some in Victoria Harbor, some online, so make sure you check that out after the service. There is a movie night for the youth this week, so parents, note the time change, 7 to 9 on Thursday. It's going to be for grade 6 through grade 12, $5 cover charge, and yeah, so just make sure that you drop off and pick up 7 to 9. Also want to let you know that we're having a membership 101 class. If you are a regular attender at MAC, if you call MAC home, I would encourage you to attend. This is a class to find out more about the denomination, what it means to be a member. A light lunch will be provided if you need some convincing. You can sign up for this online or at the welcome desk. Also, just to save the date for the women's ministry, you're going to be going bowling April 25th. Details to follow, but just mark that in your calendars. Tithes and offerings can be given in a few different ways. We have boxes at the back. We use the Tithely Giving app. You can send an e-transfer or mail or drop off. And all of your donations really go towards supporting the vision of MAC of reaching more people with the message of Jesus. So why don't we stand now and worship him together?
Thank you. Could everyone have a seat, please? And could I please have all the children up at the front? Come on up. Oh, good. Awesome. Thank you. How is everyone this morning? Good. I was lifting some weights this morning. Not. But I did bring some weights, and I have some helpers who have been working out by dancing up at the front, and I thought I'll put all that energy into great use today. Okay. There we go. All right. So a couple of weeks ago, we celebrated Easter, didn't we? Yeah. And it's not just about the Easter Bunny, is it? What's something special that happened at Easter time?
God died on the cross and rose from the dead.
I know. And exactly. And we're going to talk about Jesus rising up. But we're also going to talk about a man named Peter. Does anybody remember who Peter is? Seth?
Pardon me?
Who was Peter?
A disciple of Jesus Christ.
That's right. And Peter was a man, and he made a lot of mistakes, but he made three really big mistakes the night before Jesus died. Does anyone know what happened? Do you want Seth to help you? Yeah, okay.
He lied that he didn't know Jesus three times.
He lied three times. So today we've got a cup representing Peter. And because Peter lied three times and said he didn't know Jesus, we're going to cut the cup three times. But before we do that, before he made all of those mistakes, he had a lot of mistakes that he made. And this is going to represent Peter and the weight of his mistakes. Okay? So let's pretend that Peter's following Jesus. He's doing a great job before Jesus died. But the night that Jesus was taken and Peter denied him, we're going to cut that cup all the way down three times. Oh, boy. Peter was human, though, right? He made mistakes. All right, one more time. Should I do this side? Let's see, I might have to cut. Okay, here's the cup. It doesn't look like much, does it? Let's see if the weight can last on there. And he lied. Uh-oh. What happened? Maddie, what happened to the cup? Did it break? Look at it. That's not much of a cup anymore, is it? Well, that's kind of how Peter felt the night that he denied Jesus three times. So we're going to do something. When Jesus rose again, he asked Peter three times if he loved him. And do you know what Peter said? He said, "Yes, I do, Lord. I do love you." So the girls are going to help me, and they're going to tape around the cup. Okay? Both of you can do it. Yep. And while we're doing that, let's look at today's Bible verse. Yeah, really tight. Good job. Because Jesus forgives our sins, right?
Yeah.
Let's look at today's Bible verse, Matthew 16, 18. Here is what I tell you. You are Peter. On this rock, I will build my church. And guess what? Peter did that. His name means the rock. Isn't that cool? Yeah. Okay. Yep. You can put the last one on too. Let's see what happens now. Do you think the weight's going to be okay now? Yeah, it's not perfect, because we're not perfect, right? Let's see if it works. It is heavy. Put it right, yeah. Oh, my goodness. It's okay. It's solid now, right?
Yeah.
Just like Jesus forgave Peter. Wonderful. Let's bow our heads and let's pray. Just give me a second, Seth. Thank you, Lord, for sending Jesus to the cross so we could be saved. Lord, thank you for Jesus' disciples like Peter, who despite being imperfect, they spread your good news. May we strive to be more like Jesus every day and spread your word to others. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. Okay, let's head down.
This, and we'll continue praising. This next song, our little ladies' Bible study. We were studying Isaiah, and this is what we were studying, and we randomly broke into this song, and it was just something we had to do today. So please stand with us.
You hear me when I call. You are my morning. Amen. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for the opportunity to come to worship you. We know, Lord, you're looking for those who will worship you in spirit and in truth. And we pray today that you'll find us to be counted amongst that company. That you'll find our hearts and our minds open and honest before you. Lord, you know all of our thoughts, all of the motivations of our hearts. Truth is, so often we are misaligned, misguided, off center, off the mark, but you don't turn us away. You invite us to come. Even as you did Peter, even as we heard in that children's moment, though he fell and fell and fell again, denying that he knew you three times, still there was grace and mercy for him on the other side. And we thank you, Lord Jesus, that there's grace and mercy available to us today. No matter what we've done or haven't done, where we've been or haven't been, Lord, your love extends to each one of us. That is an incredible miracle. So today we say to you, as we just sang, that you are enough for us, Lord Jesus. You are our rock, our sure and steady foundation on which we stand. Over and above all the things of this world, that which is even good and helpful, over and above any person or relationship in this world, over and above career, achievement, material, wealth, possessions, reputation, over and above all of that, we say you are the priority. We stand on you. The rock, Christ Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for your ministry to us, no matter what we're facing. And you know what my brother, my sister, hearing these words today is facing, and you are with them in that. God, we place our confidence in you because you've said you're able to do even more than we can ask or think. So we simply turn that situation over to you, thanking you for your provision, for your making a way, even when we can't see it in the middle of it. We trust in you, O God. Hallelujah. As we come to your word now, as we continue in this series, we pray, Lord, that you'll find our hearts and minds open to what you would have for us, that this word, this truth can fall on good soil that will yield fruit in our hearts and lives. And we'll remember to give you all the praise, because we ask it in Jesus' name, giving thanks. And everyone said, amen. Please be seated. Thank you, worship team. Great to be with you this morning. And we're continuing our series today called The Ruthless Elimination of Hurry, based on the book by the same title by John Mark Comer. And like Rebecca was saying, we're going to be starting into the small groups this week. So it's a great chance to get in on that, either here. I'll be part of the big Wednesday night program happening here at the church. But as you've heard, there are going to be groups at other places, at other homes as well. It's a great thing to do together. Even if you're not a big small group person, it's only, 4, 5, 6 weeks at the most. So it's, you can see the finish line even as you start, right? So it's not too intimidating. So why don't you get in on it with us? It's going to be a great time together. Also, we have the Right Now Media that we have sent it. We've tried to send it out to everyone. And you can access this resource as well as tons of other amazing Christian faith-based resources, small group studies, personal Bible studies and devotionals. It's all like video content through Right Now Media. Really great stuff, and it's our gift to you, so you're going to want to check that out as well. If you don't have the access for that, just let us know, and we could send you that link. So last week, Pastor Rebecca introduced it, talking about the problem of hurry. Here's the first point. Hurry is an underlying problem. Our society has changed significantly in the last century, and particularly in the last 20 years. There's more information, it's faster paced, there are bigger goals, and so on. We can multitask like never before. Well, most of us. I'm actually a horrible multitasker. I'm a single tasker, but a lot of people are good at it. Despite the time-saving devices we have, we've never been so busy. There's stress on our bodies, our mental health, spiritual life. Christians can be too busy to grow in their faith and life. So our reflection question as we start the series, how are we spending our time? Just to even think about that. We might need to take an inventory to see where our time goes. Second point, hurry and love are incompatible. Hurry sabotages our ability to give and receive love with God and our neighbors. Jesus had a lot to do, a lot of people to see, and he faced tremendous pressures to meet the demands of people during his time of ministry. Despite all of that, he was able to always be loving and present. In our fast-paced, digitally distracted world, we're often busy with tasks and our minds are chronically hurried, and it doesn't look like love. How do you act when you're hurried or distracted or overwhelmed? Ouch. Number three, there is another way, and we can practice it. Don't wait until you get through this busy phase of life, whichever one you're in, to learn to walk with Jesus at his pace. It won't slow down without intentionally making choices. Take Jesus' invitation today to walk with him and learn the unforced rhythms of grace. Let's keep company with him and learn to live freely and lightly no matter the pressures we face. So we pray, thank you, Jesus, for your invitation to come and find rest in you. So there's this show, maybe you've seen it. It's called The Mandalorian. No one's seen this? Okay, thank you. It's one of these Disney shows, and it's a Star Wars knockoff, because you can never have too many Star Wars knockoffs, right? All of them are going to make you $1 billion, so why not? So anyways, The Mandalorian is cool because, first of all, that's an amazing helmet. This guy, the main guy, the Mandalorian, he's from this group of people called the Mandalorians. And they're actually a very religious and devout people. And they follow a very kind of strict code and way of life. For example, they can never remove their helmet in view of anybody else. Can you imagine that? At least you always look cool. And they have this thing where they talk about, you know, this is, you know, we're gonna do it this way, we're gonna go about it in this fashion, and whatever it might be, and then they all say together, this is the way. Yes, right? This is the way. You know, and it's very like kind of straight like that. It's like, oh, we're gonna go after these bad guys and we're gonna work as a team and we're gonna run this play and it's gonna be amazing. And then they're like, this is the way. You know, and it's a lot of fun. This is the way. And this is what we're going to talk about today, the solution, the way we can address this issue of hurry, how God can help us in following this way. We're going to look at James chapter 4 as we get started. Now listen, you who say today or tomorrow we will go to this city or that city and we'll spend a year there, we'll carry on business and make money. Why? You do not even know what will happen tomorrow. What is your life? You are a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes. Instead, you ought to say, if it is the Lord's will, we'll live and we'll do this or that. So the author here, James, he's not saying it's bad to have a plan, but rather when you plan in the absence of God or you don't factor God into the equation, the right posture is to yield whatever plans we might have to God. To say, you know what, if it's within God's will, then I'm going to go and do so-and-so. and such and such. I'm going to go here and there. I'm going to execute these plans. But the thing about that perspective is God has the trump card, right? God is ultimately the one in charge. He's ultimately the author of all of life. Not me and not you, right? We didn't kind of bring ourselves into existence. God is the author of all life. And in the end, as James says, our life is what? Merely a vapor. It's like a puff of smoke or a breath in the cold air. Right? You breathe, it's there, and then what? Gone. Just like that. This life is transitory, isn't it? We're here for as long of a season that God will give us, and most of us would like that to be a longer season. If we can get to the average Canadian age, what is it for a man? Like 85, maybe? We're thankful for that, but obviously, of course, not everyone makes it there. We just get the season God gives to us. We can do things to help ourselves a lot. We can pursue physical health. We can make wise choices, but we can't extend our expiry date. Can I get an amen? That's just the way it is. You're but a vapor, there and then gone. Luke chapter 13. Or those, this is Jesus talking, or those 18 who died when the tower in Siloam fell on them, do you think they were more guilty than all the others living in Jerusalem? I tell you, no, but unless you repent, you too will all perish. So Siloam was an area at the south end of Jerusalem where there was this famous pool of Siloam, and this was a pool that was designated for ritual bathing, and Jesus actually healed a blind man there famously. But Jesus here, he's not talking about the pool. He's actually talking about an incident that happened near the pool in that area where there was a tower that collapsed, and guess what? 18 people died. And Jesus is like, hey, you guys know about that happening, right? And of course, they did know about it. And these kind of freak accidents, they've always happened, haven't they? Did you hear about or see the pictures of this one, the Francis Scott Key Bridge in Baltimore? This massive freighter ran into the bridge, into kind of one of the piers, moving very slowly, but it didn't matter because of the size of the boat, obviously, and the weight and the momentum and the force and everything else. And the bridge promptly collapsed and fell into the water. 6 construction workers died. Obviously, the bridge is totally wiped out. This is the USA. It's the West, right? But these kind of things happen. They always have, and they always will. You can do so much to prevent them from happening, of course, but you can't guarantee that these kind of things won't happen. And in Jesus' time, when people saw these kinds of things happen, they would think that, oh, this disaster or this calamity happened to those people because they were bad, right? Because they were somehow worse than or somehow more sinful than. Somehow they were, you know, they deserved it. They'd racked up enough spiritual demerit points. They're guiltier of sin than others. But Jesus says, no, that is not the case. Not the case at all. Those who died in that accident with the tower or, you know, here on the bridge are not necessarily better or worse than anybody else. It's kind of like you're in the wrong place at the wrong time. And in the end, Jesus makes a more important point about spiritual reality. He says everyone who fails to repent is going to experience spiritual death, which is eternal separation from God. And that is what you do not want. Whether you die physically in an accident, you know, or you live a long life. Whatever the case, you do not want spiritual death. So why did they die? They died, well, because life is fragile. And we are finite creatures. We are a vapor. We are limited. We are not unlimited. Can I get an amen? This is actually the first key to learning the way that will help us address this problem of hurry. Embrace your limitations. I know it sounds like, you know, not very inspiring, but it is, I promise you. The book talks about the many limitations we have as human beings. Obviously, lifespan, as we talked about. Our bodies are what they are. They can only handle so much. How long can you even last without sleep? Not very long. You can try, and it's going to get ugly very fast. Our minds can only do so much. How many love trigonometry? See, I knew I wouldn't get any hands for that. Giftings. We only have the giftings we have. Not everyone has gifted in everything. Personalities, families of origin. We come with the parents we had. Like, we couldn't do anything about that. Who our mother, our biological mother, biological father were, the people that raised us. Maybe if it wasn't mom or dad or some kind of a mix, or it is what it is. Socioeconomic origins, education, career, where you were born and grew up in the world, right? All of these are limitations that really had essentially nothing to do with you, and they're just kind of thrust upon you. Seasons of life, God's calling. We are limited or kind of held in by all of these things. But that's not a bad thing. God designed us in such a way that we can't do everything, and that's actually a good thing. We're limited. We have limitations. Some time ago, we were down in Windsor as a family, and we went across to Detroit, Michigan, and we got to watch an NBA basketball game. And it was great because the Pistons are such a horrible team, and they're playing another terrible team. The tickets were so cheap, like way cheaper than you would ever pay for a Toronto Raptors or Toronto anything game. So it was amazing. And we got to sit actually pretty close because the tickets were so cheap. And so because we were sitting pretty close in the lower bowl, we're looking at these NBA basketball players. And both of my teenage boys play basketball, right? So it's kind of their sport. And every single one of these guys on the court is absolutely massive, right? Just blessed with amazing bodies, right? Just a little bit more muscular than me, okay? If you could picture that. No. You know, and it's very striking to me. It's like, man, these guys, it's just a wow. You know, like you really see it up close and it's just amazing, right? Not everybody can have or is blessed with the kind of genetics and kind of frame and height and size and all the rest of it to be able to do that. Most NBA players are huge in a good way. Limitations, embracing limitations doesn't mean you can't pursue your dreams, so don't hear me wrong. But rather, it's coming to terms with our finiteness and saying, I'm okay with that. Even though I can't do everything, that's okay. Right? There's that beautiful verse we looked at in our series on Philippians where Paul says, I can do everything through Christ who strengthens me. But we saw, he's not saying I can do anything and everything that comes to my mind. He's saying, by the grace of God, I'm okay. I can come through any situation he puts me in, even though I'm limited. Limitations, the book says, are where we find God's will for our lives, because we can start to see how he's wired us, how he's gifted us, where he's placed us, who he's connected us with, and how he may be calling us to extend his kingdom in our context, limited though we are. Embrace your limitations. Let's keep going to Matthew chapter 11, and we looked at this last week. But we're going to look at a different part of it today. Come to me, all of you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Okay, so the yoke was a piece of timber, like a heavy wooden pole, and it was used to connect several animals together like oxen. And then, of course, they would be employed for farming purposes or transportation. The yoke was often used biblically in a negative context, like the Israelites being under the yoke of slavery when they were in Egypt, right? Yoke. But here, Jesus presents yoke as something positive, life-giving. The book quotes a scholar named Frederick Dale Bruner who says, "A yoke is a work instrument. Thus, when Jesus offers a yoke, he offers what we might think tired workers need least. They need a mattress or a vacation, not a yoke. Jesus means that obedience to his Sermon on the Mount, his yoke, will develop in us a balance and a way of carrying life that will give more rest than the way we have been living." When Jesus invited people to follow him, he was inviting him to do what? To take his yoke upon them, to take up his way, you see. But his way was not one of slavery and misery. Remember what he said to his disciples, "I no longer call you servants or slaves. Instead, I call you what? Friends. I call you friends." Jesus describes his yoke as easy. His way is not a heavy, undue burden that you just can't wait to get out from under. That is not the way of Jesus. That is the way of self-righteous legalism, where you're trying to check all the boxes and you're trying so hard, and it's pressure and it's religion and it's effort and it's not good enough and all the rest of it, trying to prove yourself to God and the world, and you can never do it. That is not the way of Jesus. That is not his yoke. When he invites people to follow his way, he's inviting them to apprentice under him, meaning he's inviting them to learn to live as he lived. You see? He says, "Come and follow me. Learn to walk as I walk. Learn to engage in life as I do. Learn to follow my way." A quote from the book: "We've lost sight of the fact that the way of Jesus is just that, a way of life." It's so easy for Christians, and certainly evangelical Christians, to say Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, and then we just make him a doctrine, right? We just make him a belief. You just got to believe the right thing, and that is true. You know, that is obviously critically important, but there's the way, right? This is a life, okay? Here's the point. Take the easy way of Jesus. The way of Jesus is the way of attentiveness to God and others, learning to always be prioritizing what it looks like to love him and love the person in front of us. How do we know when we're walking in his way? Well, he promised if we received his way, if we took his way, his yoke upon us, we would find what? Rest for our souls. We're going to experience that rest on the inside because we're not caught up in the rat race of endless hurried production, of people pleasing, of trying to be good enough for others or ourselves or God. We're able to move past that into the way of Jesus. Note, by the way, the easy way of Jesus is not an easy life. This is not what we're saying. In fact, he said, "In this world you will have trouble." Thanks for that, Lord. "But I leave you my peace," right? So it's not about an easy life, right? Narrow is the road, difficult is the way. But even as we're going down that narrow road, that life that can be difficult, we're doing so under the yoke in the easy way of Jesus, marked by this enduring peace, being fully present to the moment at hand. Take the easy way of Jesus Christ. Let's go to Luke chapter 4. Jesus, this is right after the baptism, full of the Holy Spirit, left the Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing during those days, and at the end of them he was hungry. Yes, I believe that. So this happens right after Jesus is baptized in the Jordan by his cousin John. And He has essentially gone public now at age 30 as the Son of God. He's been affirmed by the voice of the Father saying, "This is my Son in whom I'm well pleased." And the presence of the Holy Spirit who came in the form of a dove. And the Gospels don't tell us much about Jesus' life between childhood and this moment. We just do not have much information. He was a typical Jewish boy and adolescent and then young man following in his father's trade of carpentry, most likely. And now he's about 30 years old and he's been baptized. And now he can finally burst onto the scene, right? The ministry scene. Because look, everyone saw him get baptized. Everyone heard John say, "This is the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world." So now Jesus finally, at age 30, can engage in his ministry. He can start to build his following, right? He can start to get the views and the likes on YouTube and TikTok and Instagram. He can pick up some sponsorships, right? He can get make some deals so he can make even more money on the side. And, you know, he can have that. He can build his brand, right? The Jesus brand. That's what it's all. He's got to jump on it. He's got to get busy, Jesus, with the program. No, he doesn't do any of that, does he? Right? Prime time to just get in the spotlight. And what does he do? He goes into the wilderness. Let's go to the desert. That's going to be great. What do you do there? Starve. Okay, day one on the job of being the Messiah, and he goes to the desert to engage in spiritual warfare with the devil, not for an hour or a day, but for 40 days. Couldn't he have done this in the last 30 years? He's finally on the ministry scene. There are people that need to hear his message. There are people that need to be healed, people that need to be forgiven. There are Pharisees that need to be rebuked, that need to be put in their place. There are outcasts that need to be welcomed. There are disciples that need to be made. There's so much you have to do, Jesus. Do you really need to go to the wilderness? The book says nothing could hurry this man, evidently not. In the Gospels, we read how Jesus would go away sometimes overnight for extended periods just to get away from crowds. Or he actually even slept in on occasion. So there's hope for those of you who, like me, who aren't necessarily up at 5 a.m. every morning, right? He enjoyed long meals with friends. He had in-depth conversations. He lived freely and lightly. This is not to say that he was a slackered or a lazy person or a freeloader or anything like this. Jesus was plenty busy, especially during his 3 years of public ministry, but it was a spirit-led kind of busyness where he was always open to whatever God was calling him to do in the moment, whether it was to go into the wilderness to face this temptation or to heal the blind person calling out to him for help, or to forgive the repentant sinner, or simply to get away from everyone and everything, all the noise, and pray. Jesus was attentive to the moment. And this is our last point. Be ready to respond. The way of Jesus is marked by being ready to do what God calls you to do at any moment. And this is so hard for us, right? Because we're busy and we're hurried with everything we do. And again, it's not that it's all bad, but it's just that we are so easily caught up in it. And so it's hard for us to live in this place of openness to responding to the voice of the Spirit. So this isn't us saying shirk your responsibilities, like drop out of school, you know, quit your job, leave your family and friends. We're not saying that, okay? But rather, what is it to live under the easy way of Jesus? It's to be in a kind of place where we can say, yes, God is calling me to go and get away for a few hours. Maybe it's not 40 days, but maybe it's an hour to get away and just be still with him without distraction or noise. He wants me to be ready to go. And first responders, this is what they are, what they do, right? They're ready to go at a moment's notice. You know, I get calls from the alarm company for the church here when one of our alarms goes off because, you know, the wind blew one of the doors open and then the alarm thing goes off and they call me and they say, you know, this particular thing is going off. Do you want us to send police? And I'm like, no, it's just the wind. But, because I know it, I know it's just the wind. But the point is, the police are ready to go if they get the call from the alarm company, right? They're ready to go at a moment's notice, ready to respond. It's the nature of their work. That's kind of the first responder's way. But could we be more that way, right? As people, as Christians, as followers of Jesus, as followers of the way, ready to respond to his promptings and leading. Whatever that might look like. And the rest of this series over these next 4 or so weeks is going to help us as we get into some of the practices we can do to help us better be in this way, in this posture, right? In this spirit, if you will. So, just recapping very quickly, the first point, embrace your limitations. Can I actually see God's handiwork in the ways that I am limited, right? In the things that, you know, I can do and also can't do. Can I actually see that maybe, just maybe, God is a part of that, right? And I can find peace even in the middle of those limitations. The second point, take the easy way of Jesus. Am I living under his ease and lightness? Come to me, you weary ones, and you'll find rest for your souls. Take my yoke, take my way upon you. This is an invitation to you and I. Have we said yes to it? Have we received this way, this yoke of Jesus, which is marked by ease? You will find rest for your souls, right? This is how we know we're walking in his way. What's a step you can take to lean into that, into the way of Jesus? The first one would just be pure surrender, right? Yielding of the heart and the mind, turning of the self over to the Lord, that he can be in charge, that he can be your Lord and Savior, taking his yoke, his way upon ourselves. And finally, be ready to respond. Lord, help me to be ready to do your will at any time. We can go to the last slide there. Be ready to respond. Help me to do your will at any time. I want to be someone who is not so set in my ways, my priorities, my schedules, my responsibilities, my everything, that I can't even do what you want me to do. God, help me to be open to your will, that I can follow you, to be ready to respond. Amen. Next week, we're going to be looking at silence and solitude. So that's going to be a quiet service. No, just kidding. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for the opportunity to look at the way, specifically the way of Jesus today. And for some of us, perhaps you've been around that language or that invitation for many years or decades, we pray that this can even be a fresh venture and journey for us, that we can humble ourselves to receive what you have for us through this journey, this exploration of following the way. And Lord, for those of us who perhaps this way is newer, a newer possibility, a newer adventure, we pray that there can be an openness to take upon ourselves the yoke, the way of Jesus, which is marked by an ease and a kind of lightness that is unlike anything this world can give. We thank you for this invitation, and we, Lord, want to be those who are ready to say yes to you, whatever you might be calling us to do, even if it's something really out of the ordinary or normal, or something that's not so crazy, like simply talking to someone or listening to someone in need, reaching out, helping, getting away for a time to pray, to be alone with you, whatever it might be. We want to be ready to say yes when you call us, not to put it off for another time, another season, another day, another opportunity, but to say yes in the moment. Lord, as we continue in this series, we pray that we're going to receive the encouragement and the challenge you have for us as we dig into these disciplines in the coming weeks. We'll remember to give you all the praise. I pray your blessing upon each one here. In Jesus' name we pray it. And everyone said, amen and amen. Well, it's been a joy to gather this morning. We want to pray the Lord will bless you and keep you, make his face to shine upon you, and give you peace. Let's stand together and pray the Lord's Prayer as we close our service. Let's pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. God bless you folks so much. Have a great day.